They called it Operation Northwoods. Kept secret for decades, the document was obtained by journalist James Bamford and published in his book on the National Security Agency, Body of Secrets. The author explains, in 1962, the Joint Chiefs of Staff drew up and approved what may be the most corrupt plan ever created by the U.S. government. In the name of anti-communism, they proposed launching a secret and bloody war of terrorism against their own country in order to trick the American public into supporting an ill-conceived war they intended to launch against Cuba. Among the suggestions, a fake hijacking involving remote-controlled planes to be blamed on Cuba, the blowing up of an American ship, also to be blamed on Cuba, and a terror campaign in Florida carried out by anti-Castro exiles to be blamed on Cuba. The most remarkable fact about Northwoods itself was that it was approved by every single member of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, the highest-ranking military officers in the land. Only when it reached the desks of Defense Secretary Robert McNamara and President Kennedy was the plan nixed.
The idea was to create a pretext to show that there was an attack by Cuba on the United States, and the idea was to have U.S. personnel from the CIA and other places secretly create terrorism in the United States. The documents actually said people would be shot on American streets, bombs would be blown up. And again, all this, the evidence would be laid to point the finger at Castro.
Northwoods was a proposal for what is termed in intelligence jargon, a false flag operation. For students of war, there are multiple overlapping strategies for the defeat of the enemy. The first tactic is well understood, physical violence between opposing armies. The second, far more mysterious, is psy war. In psychological operations, the target is the mind. Not just enemy personnel or infrastructure, but the beliefs, motives, and ultimately behaviors of entire societies. Alexander the Great is credited with one of the earliest recorded examples of the military psyop. When he was forced to retreat from conquered lands, vacuums of power were left in his wake. To discourage pursuers, he advised his craftsmen to build and leave behind massive body armor, such as would befit giants. Breastplates and helmets for mythical men 8 feet tall. The discovery of the objects would make his enemies think twice before giving chase. The 11th century warlord, Genghis Khan, used similar tactics of creative deception. Prior to military campaigns, agents of influence disguised as villagers from an already conquered region would be dispatched into enemy territory to warn the people of the horrors awaiting them. To further intimidate opponents, Khan devised a trick of light, As darkness fell over his encampments, he ordered his men to light 5 campfires, where only one was necessary. Observing the spectacle, one scout reported back that Khan's army had more fires than there are stars in the sky. In the modern age, psy war would evolve into an art form. President Eisenhower defined psychological warfare as anything from the singing of a beautiful anthem up to the most extraordinary kind of physical sabotage.
Black propaganda, well, let's start with the white propaganda. White propaganda is propaganda, persuasion, news, media operations of one sort or another that are openly acknowledged by their sponsor, which in this particular case is the U.S. government. So the Voice of America, for example, is white propaganda. Black propaganda, on the other hand, is disavowed by the agency that's sponsoring it. It operates on the basis of plausible deniability, so that if something goes sour or the true goals, the true nature of the propaganda is revealed, then the actual sponsor can say, no, we didn't do that. We didn't have anything to do with that. The accusations that we had something to do with it are just completely wrong. They're a fantasy, and so on. So black propaganda involves both media operations on the one hand, persuasion, publicity, but typically it will be media that poses as opposed to the sponsor in order to discredit the side that's being attacked. Let me give you an example of how that works. Suppose you're in the middle of the Cold War. There's a radio battle, and this is actually a rather benign form, comparatively, of black propaganda. There's a radio battle between East and West, and one side or the other creates a radio station that poses as being the other side's voice, and then says outlandish, stupid, provably false, or very hostile things about the first side. Okay, well then the first side can use that as its own propaganda by saying, see, this is the people that we're dealing with. They're completely nuts, or they're completely corrupt, or they have no integrity, or a whole range of other types of accusations.
The false flag operation takes the concept of black propaganda to a murderous extreme. Secret agents carry out an act of terrorism or other outrage, which is then blamed on the enemy of choice. Oftentimes, false flags are perpetrated by what Lawrence Klein of the U.S. Army War College called a pseudo-team, individuals who are organized to impersonate enemy forces. Citing examples from the Hugue insurrection in the Philippines, the Mau Mau in Kenya, the French in Indochina, and other conflicts, Klein stresses their utility in intelligence gathering. But there are other, more important uses. In 1951, the democratically elected leader of Iran, Mohammad Mossadegh, was overthrown by the CIA and replaced by the fascist Shah. The man in charge of organizing the coup, Kermit Roosevelt, explicitly referred in his memoirs to the use of false flag operations. In the year 2000, New York Times reporter James Risen obtained a previously secret account of the coup written by CIA agent Donald Wilbur. Risen explains, in early August, the CIA, seeking to stir up anti-communist sentiment in the religious community, stepped up the pressure. Iranian operatives pretending to be communists threaten Muslim leaders with savage punishment if they oppose Mossadegh. In addition, the house of at least one prominent cleric was bombed by CIA agents posing as communists. The fact that Mossadegh was not a communist to begin with was of little concern to the plotters. The real threat was an independent Iran in control of its own oil reserves. Coinciding with the false flags, mobs were paid by the CIA to riot in the streets. In his book, CIA Diary, CIA whistleblower Philip Agee indicates that the tactics used during the coup in Iran became a matter of routine. In some cases, a timely bombing by a station agent, followed by mass demonstrations, and finally by intervention by military leaders in the name of the restoration of order and national unity is a useful course. During the brutal occupation of Algeria by France, an even more elaborate pseudo-team was created. In the mid-1950s, the Direction de la Surveillance de Territoire formed a group known as the Organization of the French Algerian Resistance, or ORAF. Posing as members of the anti-colonial resistance, ORAF committed false flag bombings, targeting civilians with the aim of quashing any hopes of political compromise. Sometimes, false flag operations fail. Under Operation Susanna, in 1954, Israeli military intelligence attempted to carry out a series of false flag bombings in Egypt. The targets were to be American and British businesses, and were to be blamed on the Muslim Brotherhood. According to Israeli historian Shabtai Tebeth, the assignment was to undermine Western confidence in the existing Egyptian regime by generating public insecurity and actions to bring about arrests, demonstrations, and acts of revenge while totally concealing the Israeli factor. The operation was cut short before the bloodshed could begin. Conspirator Philip Nathanson was caught attempting to detonate a bomb in a British-owned theater. Israeli Defense Minister Pinhas Levin resigned over the affair. Some false flags meet with initial success, only to create blowback at a later date. During the attempted coup in Venezuela, anti-Chavez forces intentionally fired on their own supporters, killing several people. The goal was to create the illusion of a popular uprising and government crackdown. The coup plotters, along with Bush administration spokesman Ari Fleischer, appeared on television denouncing the alleged government attacks and offering support for the coup government.
We know that the action encouraged by the Chavez government provoked this crisis. The Chavez government suppressed peaceful demonstrations, fired on unarmed, peaceful protesters, resulting in 10 killed and 100 wounded.
Venezolanos, el presidente de la República ha traicionado la confianza de su pueblo. Está masacrando a personas inocentes con francotiradores. Para este momento van 6 muertos y decenas de heridos en Caracas. Esto no lo podemos permitir. No podemos aceptar un tirano en la República de Venezuela.
It was later revealed that the military officials filmed the segment before the murders took place, exposing their actual sponsorship.
El día 10 en la noche me llaman por teléfono y me dicen la marcha se va hacia el Palacio de Miraflores, va a haber unos muertos y aparecen 20 militares de alto rango pronunciándose en contra del gobierno de Chávez y pidiendo la renuncia al presidente. En esa prueba ya se habla de muertos cuando todavía no había un solo muerto en la calle y todo sigue como estaba programado.
Gladio, così come è stata definita, individuata, descritta oggi, è una componente di quelle che io ho sempre chiamato strutture parallele. C'è un esercito invisibile, non predisposto per una battaglia, una guerra esterna contro un ipotetico invasore, ma addestrato ad operare all'interno contro quello che in tutti gli ambienti militari è stato sempre definito una quinta colonna dell'Unione Sovietica, il Partito Comunista e le forze di estrema sinistra adesso collegato.
For 40 years, secret terrorist organizations, many trained by Western intelligence agencies, have manipulated the political control of European sovereign states by a campaign of terror and murder. Originally part of a secret network, these groups changed from being defenders of state security into attackers of the established political order. Until 2 years ago, that secret network was generally known by the single word, Gladio.
Operation Gladio was a secret, highly classified operation that was initiated by Prime Minister Winston Churchill in around the 40s and 50s. At its inception, Churchill intended to set up a secret European-wide cell of military units that would basically be able to mobilize in response to a potential invasion of Western Europe by communist Russia. Now, these cells were actually set up with the support of the United States. NATO was the main vehicle. It was done secretly across many Western European countries. And over time, it evolved into a highly kind of disturbing form of covert action. And Operation Gladio was actually a specific operation as part of this overall process, which was taking place in Italy. What we can say for certain is that within about 10 years, this phenomenon that we saw in Operation Gladio became much more than what Churchill had originally described it was intended to be. And in the end, we had a situation where these actual cells were given the task of actually carrying out various kind of actions, including terrorist activity in different parts of Western Europe, in order to project blame onto left-wing or communist social movements.
The stay-behind networks had been set up to repel a Soviet invasion. Yet the invasion never came. In 1968, a brief for the British Chiefs of Staff noted that the Soviet Union will not deliberately start general war or even limited war in Europe, and that Soviet foreign policy has been cautious and realistic. Nevertheless, the myth of Soviet expansionism remained an important component of Cold War propaganda.
What we are watching is a four-phased operation. Phase one has been completed, the seizure of Nicaragua. Next is El Salvador, to be followed by Honduras and Guatemala. It's clear and explicit.
There is a Caribbean domino
of course
theory that's unfolding.
Well, I wouldn't call it necessarily a domino theory. I would call it a priority target list, a hit list, if you will, for the ultimate takeover of Central America.
In addition to justifying imperialism abroad, the myth of the international communist conspiracy would also play out domestically. In Europe, Gladio would provide the ammunition. The stay-behind networks had been supplied with massive amounts of military equipment, including explosive devices, which were stored in secret locations across the continent. In some countries, churches were used. With no Soviet army to repel, the fascists increasingly focused on what they regarded as the enemy within. False flag terror would be their primary weapon. Operation Gladio and related programs in other European nations were kept secret for decades, but eventually revealed in a series of judicial and congressional investigations in the early 1990s. In Italy, the program was closely linked to a Masonic league known as P2, or Propaganda Due. It was made up of military and intelligence officers, political leaders, industrialists, mafioso, bankers, and even Vatican contacts. Among its current members is recent Italian Prime Minister Silvio Berlusconi. During his tenure as Prime Minister, Berlusconi openly expressed admiration for Mussolini and the philosophy of fascism. During the initial stages of Gladio, P2 was chaired by another avowed fascist, Lucio Gelli. A 1969 memo from Magenta Press, a fascist front group, is explicit about Gladio's tactics. Acts of terrorism will seem to have emanated from our adversaries and pressure brought to bear on people in whom power is invested at every level. That will create a feeling of hostility. At the same time, we must rise up as defender of the citizenry against the disintegration brought about by terrorism and subversion. Even more explicit was Gladio participant Vincenzo Vincenguerra, who went on the record for the BBC, stating outright the shocking mission and targets of Gladio. It was called the strategy of tension.
Bisognava attaccare i civili, quello che è il popolo, le donne, i bambini, le persone innocenti, strane ad ogni gioco politico. Per una ragione semplice, perché bisognava obbligare questa gente, l'opinione pubblica italiana, a rivolgersi allo Stato, a rivolgersi al regime per chiedere maggiore sicurezza. Il ruolo della destra d'Italia è stato proprio questo. Si è messa a servizio di apparati di Stato che hanno alimentato una strategia che giustamente è stata definita della tensione, in quanto bisognava portare la gente ad accettare in qualsiasi momento, nell'arco di un trentennio, dal 1960 al 1985-86, la possibilità di uno stato d'emergenza. Quindi la gente avrebbe barattato molto volentieri parte della sua libertà con la sicurezza di poter camminare sulle strade, viaggiare sui treni, salire sugli aerei, entrare in banca. Questa è la logica politica che sta dietro tutte le stragi, che rimangono impunite proprio perché lo Stato non può condannare se stesso o proclamare se stesso colpevole.
It did seem to be the case that for the most part civilian governments were not aware of the nature of these operations going on and were completely shocked when they discovered that you had CIA and MI6 through NATO effectively infiltrating their own intelligence services and operating autonomous subsections of these agencies in order to carry out these kind of operations. In most cases we did find, however, that there were specific members of the civilian government who were aware. Either it could have been a defense minister, for example, it might have been the prime minister alone, but it varied from case to case.
One of the first major bombings in Italy occurred on December 12, 1969, at the Banca Nazionale dell'Agricoltura. 16 people were killed and another 88 wounded when fascists detonated an explosive device. An anarchist named Giuseppe Pinelli was blamed. He took the fall for the bombing, literally, when police threw him out of the window of a local precinct. In Belgium, the machine gun became the weapon of choice. In the mid-1980s, masked terrorists began strolling into supermarkets and opening fire on men, women, and children.
En hij ziet het draaien, gemaskerde mannen uit hun dingen ervan achterkomen. En hij zegt tegen zijn klein, laat u vallen, zeitje, want ze zijn daar. En daarmee is hij willen vluchten. Nee. En hebben zijn direct op hem geschoten. Nee. Zeven of acht kogels door zijn notto. En hier is schamschot, juist in zijn schedel en hier achter zijn oor.
Ik heb één vrouw zien komen af, komen gelopen, volledig in haar gezicht bebloed en haar benen en al. En die is dan overgelopen in paniek van haar kind, iets van een kind, wat dat juist was, weet ik niet, man.
Described in the press as the supermarket massacres, they were linked by the Belgian parliament to their Gladio unit. It was later suggested that one of the aims of the supermarket massacres was to encourage a right-wing government that would be more amenable to accepting U.S. proposals for stationing nuclear-tipped missiles in Belgium.
The dinner was ready and we were waiting for my daughter, my son-in-law and their two children. Saturday was our family day. All of a sudden I heard shooting from the Delhaize supermarket. We ran out to the terrace and my wife screamed, my children. I said, calm down, I will have a look at what happened. The doors to the supermarket were wide open and a crowd was pushing out. I wanted to go in, against the tide, but people were saying, don't. People have been shot in there. Then they told me that my whole family had been shot.
The strategy of tension was a Europe-wide enterprise.
Prima linea era diretta a fare degli attentati per farli ricadere sulla sinistra, la seconda linea invece era di infiltrazione nei gruppi di sinistra e per indurre anche questi gruppi estremistici della sinistra extraparlamentare a fare degli attentati e quindi a inserirsi in questa strategia che mirava ad acuire l'attenzione allora sociale e politica nel paese.
The first one was to organize gangs to do hold up hostage, you know, and killing. The second one was to organize a so-called left movement who will do a terrorist attempt just to make believe, make the population believe that these terrorist attempts were done by the left.
In some of these cases, you had situations where you had local left-wing groups who had emerged organically on the basis of perfectly normal domestic kind of dynamics and were infiltrated and manipulated by intelligence agencies to instigate these acts of provocation and to take the blame. So that gives you an example where organic forms of political movements, whether or not they're involved in terrorism at the beginning, can be infiltrated, manipulated, mobilized by states to carry out this kind of activity. And there are many, many examples from the historical record.
they try to escape across the street where Jesus stripped bare and raped the spirit he was supposed to nurture. In the name of mine. In the name of mine.
Basically waves of terrorist bombings and atrocities carried out in Turkey, in Italy, in Greece, in Spain, in many parts of Western Europe. And in all of these cases, we have strong evidence that these instances were actually mobilized by these secret cells that were co-opted by NATO. What actually did happen subsequently is that the civilian governments of these countries did respond to these atrocities, believing them to have been conducted by left-wing groups. And it did create a massive kind of drive against left-wing movements to encroach on civil liberties, to really kind of conduct very draconian policies, both at home and abroad. What we learned from Operation Gladio is that intelligence and covert action as carried out by states is clearly something which is routinely conducted under the radar, and that it's often conducted in such a way that civilian administrations are not fully aware of what is going on. And to be honest with you, I think this is not really something controversial. I mean, anyone who has genuinely studied covert operations and the nature and structure of intelligence agencies will be aware that the whole point of covert action is precisely to conceal it from public awareness. The danger of it is clearly that when you have a case like Operation Gladio, or the strategy of tension documented during the Cold War, this really reveals how far intelligence agencies are able to go as a consequence of that. And that raises a lot of disturbing questions about really the scope of the intelligence agencies and their capacity to conduct very, very dangerous covert action, which is not in the interests of the wider public, which is not in the national interest, and which violates even the basic kind of rule of law that is established by the civilian government.
False flag operations have not only been used to demonize dissidents and topple governments, they've also been used as sparks to ignite world wars. In 1931, the Japanese blew up several stretches of their own railroads in the Chinese region of Manchuria. The attacks were blamed on Chinese rebels, providing a pretext for the Japanese to invade. Similarly, in 1939, the Nazis faked an attack on a German radio station in Gleiwitz.
Polnische Aufständischen Verband! Jeder Widerstand ist zwecklos und wird sofort gebrochen. Wer sich uns in den Weg stellt, Skinje, wird niedergeschlagen.
They took a concentration camp victim, dressed him in a Polish army uniform, then left his body at the crime scene in order to implicate the Polish government. In this case, the result was nothing less than World War II. False flags are not necessary to start wars, but they serve an important function. They allow the aggressor state to portray itself as the victim while rallying public opinion behind the war effort. In fact, they needn't even involve real physical events. The Gulf of Tonkin incident, in which it was alleged that North Vietnamese forces attacked an American naval vessel, was entirely fictitious.
Shortly after noon, the calm of the day is broken at General Quarters Sound. In a deliberate and unprovoked action, three North Vietnam PT boats unleash a torpedo attack against the Manning.
The destroyer was carrying out a mission of patrol in those waters, in international waters, when it was attacked.
Well, I think it's a very clear demonstration of the unity of the country behind the policies that are being followed by the president in South Vietnam, and more specifically of the action that was taken in response to the attack upon our destroyers.
The Tonkin incident never happened. Yet, it allowed for a vast expansion of the American war effort in Vietnam.
These kinds of operations, they're effective in the short run, particularly because all the information comes from the U.S. government, and secondly, the media so submissive to relay whatever the government says happened rather than investigate in greater depth the circumstances surrounding these false flag operations. So they're successful to the degree in which they monopolize the government and the mass media conform to the message which has been sent out.
In light of the immense historical consequences of false flag operations, one might assume that they would be the subject of continual and extensive study by journalists and scholars. Yet, if anything, the opposite is true. False flags remain one of the biggest taboos in journalism. In order to sidestep the issue, and deep politics as a whole, many journalists and academics have created a workaround. They call it conspiracy theory.
How much would you attribute the increase in conspiratorial thinking to that red line?
There has been an explosion of conspiracy theories flying fast and furious over the internet.
Those conspiracy people,
a lot of the conspiracy theories, of course, 9/11 conspiracy theory goes back to the Bush era.
I'm Jesse Ventura, and this is conspiracy theory.
Well, conspiracy mongering.
Fringe conspiracy theorists.
Conspiracy theory. Conspiracy theorists.
The people who foment conspiracy theories, crazy conspiracy theories, full-blown American conspiracy theories are a great American pastime. And not all of them are on the right. There's plenty on the left as well.
Never told a soul about it. In fact, they engaged in a vast conspiracy.
Since you get accused of being a conspiracy theorist, speculation, conspiracy theories.
Let us never tolerate outrageous conspiracy theories.
Painting this type of picture
only feeds the delusions of those who wear tinfoil hats around their house.
You know, there have always been crazy people who gravitate, if they have schizophrenia, who gravitate toward conspiracy theories.
Those true believers in the mystic power of New Age crystals, spirit channeling, of people who talk to trees.
Now, I don't consider myself a conspiracy buff at all, but when they get a lot of coincidences, I get a little suspicious.
How does this term conspiracy theory get used, and what are the purposes that it's used for? Conspiracy theory is a little bit like the word propaganda, and it's used specifically to discredit someone and to say, in effect, you're nuts, you're making it up, or you don't know you don't have knowledge about this, or that you're irrational. That's the description of a conspiracy theory. So that is a very effective way and frequently used in the mass media and by media commentators and reporters as a means of discrediting points of view that they don't agree with.
Conspiracy theory is a term that's used whenever anybody ascribes conscious intent to people with power. So I can say to you that school teachers are concerned about their salaries, and they're organizing, and they're threatening a strike, and they're pressuring. I can say to you that farmers are doing this and looking for subsidies and facing certain policies. But the minute I say to you that the very people at the top, the plutocracy, the very rich and powerful, the ones who own most of America, that they are consciously pursuing power and wealth, someone will come along and say, what do you have, a conspiracy theory? Or they'll say, oh, you're cynical or you're paranoid. Their view is that stuff just happens. Things just happen, unintended consequences, or our leaders are stupid and they're jerks, or they're confused and they don't know any better. And of course, the critic knows much better than everybody else. People who operate in this world operate with intent. There's no such thing as imperialism without imperialists. There's no such thing as capitalism without capitalists. There's no such thing as rulers who are somnambulists who walk around in their sleep. You watch out for your interests. You watch out and you make calculations. What makes you think that David Rockefeller doesn't? What makes you think that the people at the top don't do it? And what makes you think they don't collude and organize? Oh, what do you think? You have a group of people who sit around in a room and they plan this? And I always say, oh no, God, they don't sit around in a room. They meet on carousels and they go up and down and merry-go-rounds, or they meet skydiving and they hold hands and they argue. Of course they sit in rooms. Where the hell else are they going to meet?
Popular usage of the term conspiracy theory does not appear to closely correlate with evidence in support of a particular assertion. British Prime Minister Tony Blair dismissed the idea that the invasion of Iraq may have been motivated by oil as an absurd conspiracy theory. In fact, the most absurd conspiracy theories are often promoted by the most powerful individuals in society, including Tony Blair himself. His claim that Iraq had retained massive amounts of chemical and biological weapons and was plotting with Al-Qaeda to attack the West had zero evidentiary support. The Third Reich promoted the conspiracy theory that Jews were responsible for most of the world's ills. During the Cold War, American policy planners claimed that the Kremlin was engaged in a worldwide communist conspiracy, even while their own intelligence reports suggested the opposite. More recently, Muslims have become the primary scapegoat. In 2008, the John McCain presidential campaign mailed out 28 million copies of the pseudo-documentary Obsession, a hate film suggesting that Muslims are engaged in a massive conspiracy to create a worldwide Islamic dictatorship. On the populist right, macro-conspiracy theories are often used to deflect attention from class analysis while encouraging scapegoating.
These are the big players in the world right now on the things that are happening. Big education, is fundamentally involved in everything that is happening. Soros, the Tides Foundation, Open Society. Anonymous is now starting to take a big role. SEIU and AFL-CIO. Russia and Putin is now in control. I remember I said that about 8 years ago. And I said, Putin's going to, he's going to come roaring back. Oh, that's crazy. Yeah, really. Here's Occupy Wall Street, Islamic extremism, Iran, the White House, and the media. These are all the real players that are causing so many problems right now.
What's a conspiracy? And what to what is everything that somebody says happened? Does that mean that that's actually happened? Some of the stuff that people believe about the CIA or the National Security State or Jews or black people or Wall Street or, you know, you name it, liberal media, right-wing media. Some of the things that people believe about, all of those controversial things, are not true. And so we get into a situation in which the accusation that a conspiracy exists or that there's a plan afoot to do something becomes a powerful political tool. One of the most powerful tools of propaganda is rumors, rumor mongering. And one can see it even in elections, you can see it in international affairs and so forth. Rumors appeal to people's primal fears, fears about race, fears about gender, fears about their own relationship between themselves and authority, those sorts of things. And there are plenty of people out there who will exploit those fears. And it's quite difficult for ordinary people who are living their lives to card out, well, what is just nonsense from what is incredible yet real. There's no simple solution to this problem. Present-day media tends to encourage people to believe in nonsense by giving credibility to it on the one hand, and on the other hand, oftentimes, not always, denying the reality of evidence that is substantial. I think that the way to get at this in a social sense is to keep an open mind, investigate carefully, and not to believe in stuff that you don't understand. We as scholars, teachers, media people, just as ordinary citizens, should not propagate stuff that they don't understand or that they don't have factual support for.
You know, the term conspiracy theory is a very interesting one. It is, of course, applied to almost anything that's perceived as threatening, any kind of broader attempt to explain specific events. There certainly are people and elements out there that create these explanations for everything, and those are potentially dangerous because they do lead to scapegoating. On the other hand, there are actual people, actual covert operations, actual things happening that we don't know about, and it's very, very important to understand them. I mean, they are fundamentally conspiracies, which simply means several people colluding in a secret and illegal operation. Conspiracies are prosecuted every day in the courtrooms of this country, and theory is what we use to try to understand things. So I find the term conspiracy theory a broad brush pejorative, which I think is designed to suppress discussion. I do think we need to distinguish between those who see a bogeyman everywhere and those who do careful research and come to the conclusion in particular cases that there was some sort of an organized effort to do something, perhaps to remove a president or to achieve some other change of which the public was never informed.
If you're going to look and say that, you know, it's structures and systems that run the world, you have to realize that there are trap doors in these structures and systems, and that not all of the structure, not all of the system is visible in the public record. And that's where we come back to what I say about deep politics and a deep state. We have to acknowledge that there are processes going on that are not finding their way straight away into newspapers and history books, And it's so interesting that America can see that about other countries, just has problems seeing it about itself.